espalhar.
I'd like to appreciate the leadership of the LPED, Simon Zweli and everybody else who's in the LPED, the council and the ESCO of CAF, and all of you for coming. The last time I was here, most of you were here, and I thank God that you are back. Today, I'm with my sister Zu, Ancient Robber. She's a patron. She was here in 2011. Studying, become accounting. She's now a CA. She's a woman of God. She's married with two sons. So you can say hi to her. Accounting is difficult. Through the tutorials. So make sure that you see her. Make sure that she doesn't leave without seeing you.
So the other time we are in church, you. I don't want to say jokes, but you know, you know they say you are a clown and you are 40 heads. Marie Boutine. So, who go get Woodsy? And here's what I'm saying, you could manage to do it. Who go to the bank? I'm going to let a lady who's in a vest.
So I think his understanding was that since Jesus was in the manger, the only clothes that he could get were the vest. So just to have a village was fell up on earth, but it was a vest. Matthew chapter 4. The first step of leading is following Christ. That's what we're going to be talking about today. Where's my brother?
No, but my vocabulary will not get there. No, I went to school at the wrong time. Right? When we were still fighting for our things, so we enjoyed more than we learned English. So I'm very good at enjoying, but English is still getting there. So we're going to go to the book of Matthew chapter 4, and we are going to do a bit of a study there. We are going to look at Jesus and the disciples from two angles. Right? So the first angle is we are going to look at how Jesus leads. How Jesus leads. Because Jesus, I'm sure all of us, we understand that he was a really great and powerful leader. And the power of his leadership is not so much in the followers he had while he was still alive on earth, but it's that his mission is alive even today. There's a supernatural bit to it. A very important part of it is supernatural, is because Jesus is the Son of God. But there is something that all of us can learn from the model of Jesus, the model of leadership that Jesus employed, that if we use it in our families, in our lives, we will be very successful with our leadership. We won't be seasonal leadership leaders. We won't be leaders that are only successful for a time, or we won't be leaders who are successful only when there are people who agree with us. So Jesus was successful even when they disagreed with him to the point of death. They followed him even after they had killed him. So that's how powerful he was. So we're going to look at it from a point of view of how Jesus led, but I also want you to look at it from the disciples' point of view, how they were raised to be leaders. Okay? So every time we look at the text, we will be looking at it. We'll be looking at Jesus and how he is leading. But we are also going to put ourselves in the shoes of the disciples, because at that time they were being led. Not this being led of yours where you see a man in a suit and then you put him on Instagram and you say, Bazalwane, we are led. I'm talking about really where leadership principles are applied and people are growing from one level to the next. So let's go to the book of Matthew chapter 4 and let's start from verse 12. So if you look at verse 1 to verse 11, Jesus goes into the desert. Jesus is led there by the Holy Spirit. And when he gets there, he's tempted. He fasts for 40 days and 40 nights. And towards the end of his fast, the devil tempts him. And that's where he says, it is written, it is written. And then the fast ends. And then in my Bible, which is the New King James, when it starts, verse 12, it starts by saying, Jesus begins his Galilean ministry. Do you see that I'm trying to teach more than preach? Do you see that? Am I succeeding so far?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, when I'm failing, just raise your hands so that I can go back to teaching. So the Bible here says, in my Bible, it's a heading, it says Jesus begins his Galilean ministry. Ne? Verse 12. Now, when Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he departed to Galilee. For those of you who have heard me preach before, you know that I generally have a bit of an issue with things like this. When you hear that your cousin is in prison, like, what would other normal people do? Go and visit him in prison, send him a letter. You know, the normal things, not Jesus, he goes to Galilee. Because it is the fact that John is in prison cannot disturb a kingdom agenda that he's here to achieve. He is here, it's time now to start his ministry. And so many of us, we fail in this area. Let me give you a brief example of something that happened to me today. I woke up at 3 o'clock this morning to cook. Because when you are at home, you're not a pastor, you're a daughter. So I woke up at home to cook because it's my father's ordination and birthday. So I've been cooking since 3 o'clock in the morning, cooking, giving, making food, washing dishes, doing all these things. And unfortunately, the party did not start as it was supposed to start. It ended up starting, I think, at 3. But for me to be here on time, I had to leave Polokwane at 2. So I left before the party started. And when I was driving back alone, very drowsy because I did not sleep, I was asking myself, where am I going? Mancha, where are you going? Why don't you stay here? Celebrate with your father. Be in the party. Why are you going to get... Do you know those children? Who's their father? Your father is here having a party. Why are you leaving your father's party to go to preach at Kev? But when you understand what your mission on earth is, you will be very jealous with allowing earthly agendas to disturb your kingdom agenda. But when your kingdom agenda is not strong, it's very easy for you to shift and move things. So I am here because there's an agenda that God has for my life, for this generation. And this message is an important part of that agenda. Yes, it's important for me to get my father's party. That's why I've been cooking since 3. So that by the time I leave, I can show him all the pots I cook. This one, my wife was cooked by me, and this one, and this one, and this one. Now that I'm leaving and going to Kev, the pots will give you company, the pots I cooked and bought yesterday. So Jesus understood something that it would be very important for you to understand. You know, I should not make examples like this because you guys love laughing at people's misery. But I actually remember in 2013, when I was supposed to be married, when the person says supposed, it didn't happen. And when I was supposed to be married, and I just remember how on the Wednesday, I found out that the man that I've introduced to my family that was coming to pay Nobola, that was supposed to marry me, was not who he said he was. And on a Thursday, I ended the relationship. And on a Sunday, I was preaching. And when I was going to preach, I think even you are powerful, you don't get hurt. When I was, now I'm not that powerful, I haven't reached that level of power yet. When I was driving to go to preach, I remember I was on some medication called Rakuten that makes your eyes to be painful, to sting. And you know, as I was driving to go and preach twice in Pretoria, I was actually crying on the way there. And God kept reminding me, Mancha, you can never put a kingdom agenda on pause because your feelings are hurt. Yeah. And I was like, Mara, why would you run first? I need to heal first. Yeah, when I get there, I could not say, guys, please stretch your hands towards the woman of God and pray for me. I'm not quiet. I had to go there and I had to preach the gospel, and nobody knew that I had ended an engagement, and I had to go and explain to my father why the Lord is not coming. And my father had been calculating since the day. So Jesus, even though there was a pressing personal matter in his life, understood that his agenda went beyond what he needed to do for John the Baptist. And to be fair, even John the Baptist, when you look at him, when he was in jail, he never said, guys, why don't you ask my cousin why he's not coming to visit me? When he was in jail, he said, find out for me, is it the Messiah that we have been waiting for? So he was not even trying to find out, oh, but we are related. When I jumped at you when your mother was pregnant and you were young, he was not trying to go back to those personal things. He was speaking to kingdom issues. So many of us, we fail. Even some of the people that God brings into your life, you are a woman and God brings a man into your life, or you are a man and God brings a woman into your life for a kingdom agenda. You mistake that kingdom agenda and you think it's for romantic purposes. So many of us end up getting involved with people that we should be partnering with in the ministry. coach, because you could not distinguish between a kingdom partnership and a romantic relationship. And even when it breaks your crying, but deep down you know this was not the purpose of this thing. This had a higher purpose, and because of my own selfish agenda and my own selfish reasons, I hijacked a kingdom agenda for my personal purposes. So Jesus, even though he saw that, you know what, there's a personal matter that I need to attend to, he also knew that this is the time where I need to begin my ministry. And leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is by the sea, in the regions of Zebulun and Naphtali, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, "The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and upon those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light was dawned." So one of the things that I want you to observe about Jesus, I mean, look at everything, even his birth, how even Joseph had to organize with Mary for them to move because they were trying to save his life. You see that everything about Jesus' life is about the fulfillment of the word of God. And that's how our lives must be as well. Our lives must be centered around what God prophesied about us as his children, and us as the kingdom of God, and us as the church. So that even when certain personal things stand in the way of the kingdom of God, you are able to put them aside, because you know that at the end of the day, my main objective is to make sure that the word of God comes to pass wherever I am. I don't ever want to find myself feeling an obstacle for the fulfillment of the word of God. I don't want to be that one person who says, "No, the word won't happen when I'm here." I want to be the person that says, if God has said it, it is my responsibility to make sure that if there's anything that I can do to fulfill the word, let me do it. If at least then, let me be out of the way so that God can do what he needs to do. From that time, Jesus began. So do you see that all along, Jesus had not done any form of ministry? He had not healed anyone. He had not delivered anyone from demons. He had not done any, he had not even preached. And for the first time, remember when he was 12 years old, guys, he didn't preach. So I know that many of us, when we want to encourage our young children to start preaching quickly, we say to them, "Jesus preached when he was 12 years old in the temple." No, guys, he didn't preach. Go back to your Bibles and read what happened in Luke. So only now does he begin to preach. And when he begins to preach, he says, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. For the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Then we go to verse 18. My Bible again has a heading here. It says, "Four fishermen called as disciples. And Jesus," verse 18, "walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and Andrew his brother. They were casting a net into the sea." So two brothers, they are by the Sea of Galilee. They tell us their names and they tell us what they were doing there. They were casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. So they were fishing. Then he said to them, "Follow me and I will make you fishers of men." They immediately left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers. It's not the same brothers, you see it. Two other brothers, James the son of Zebedee and John his brother, in the boat with Zebedee their father, mending their nets. What were the first ones doing? And the second ones? He called them, and immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus is calling people that are not idle. Jesus is calling people that are busy with something. Both brothers were working. Both brothers were busy with meaningful work. They were actually running their own businesses as fishermen. And when Jesus arrived there, he never said to them, "Leave your boats." He never said to them, "Leave your business." He never said to them, "Leave what you are doing." He said to them, "Follow me." There is a difference between leaving something and following something. So when you leave a job, you are leaving it because you are fed up or because you don't want to work there anymore. But if you find a better job, you are not leaving a job, you are going to a job. So the disciples
did not leave their vocation. The disciples did not leave their business. The disciples followed Jesus because he offered something higher than what they were busy with. It is Pastor Joel Kekana, who about 20-something years ago said to us, when two powers meet, the lesser power must bow. So when God finds you fishing for fish, and when you are fishing, you have a 5-year plan, 20-year plan about what it looks like to fish based on your research, based on forecast, based on experience, on your education, on your aptitude, on a whole lot of other things. You have a 10, 20-year plan about how your life as a fisherman is going to look like. And because you don't know any better, when you look at it, you say, this is where I'm going. But when God comes with a plan of fishing for men, you look at your plan, you look at God's plan, and you realize that God is introducing a higher plan. When a higher plan comes into your life, you don't make room in your current life. You follow the plan. You are not living your current life. You are following the new plan because it is a better plan. The reason why we don't follow Jesus completely is because we think he's offering us something that is less than what we already have. The minute we understand that Jesus is offering us something better, it will be easy for us not to leave what we have. It will be easy for us to follow what Jesus offers. The second thing that I want you to realize about the disciples, to be honest, no one knew what it meant to fish men. What is it? What is it? I mean, evangelism was not a big thing. Because it was clear that Jesus, God had chosen the children of Israel, and they were just his children because God chose them. So there was no need for them to go to the Gentiles, to the Samaritans, to whoever, and say, come and join us. Because those people were not the chosen people of God. But now Jesus is introducing a different way. So we knew that for you to be part of the kingdom of Israel, you had to be born into the kingdom of Israel. But now Jesus is saying, I'm introducing a kingdom of heaven. And this kingdom of heaven, you are not going to get into it by birth. This kingdom of heaven, you are going to get into it because you accept me as the Lord and Savior of your life. So for me to go and spread this new knowledge all over the world, I need to raise fishers of men so that they can go to all the ends of the earth and tell the people, repent, for the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So that people who never knew about the kingdom can not only know about the kingdom, but so that those people can also enter the kingdom. It was a new thing. They didn't know what it looked like. They didn't know what the training to become a fisher of men looked like. So let me just quickly go back to where we were initially, where I say when God comes into your life and asks you to follow him, he gives you a better plan than the plan that you were busy with without him. So I like this example, and maybe I've shared it with some of you before. So back at home, we have these shops, Chama Pakistan, or Chama Somalia, or Chama Kula, or Chama India. I think some of you in your villages, you may have them in your townships. And generally, when you go to buy those shops, if you buy something big, they give you a parcela. They give you something for free. Do you guys look too bourgeoisie? Do you know, are you guys aware of something like that? Just raise your hand if you know what I'm talking about. So if you buy something big at those shops, they give something. That does not happen at Woolworths, guys. You can buy all the groceries, fill all the trolleys, they'll never give you anything for free. But at those shops, if you buy something big, they give you something for free. So if my child comes to me, and I call my brother's son, his name is Mukhali, and I say, Mukhali, go to the shop and buy 80 kilograms of milimili. Are you guys aware of that size of milimili? I think if you are bourgeoisie, you can't buy milimili that big. I mean, our grandmothers used to buy that thing, Joe. It would get rotten and have worms. And then they would get a sieve and we remove the worms and eat the milimili. Like, why didn't they just buy a smaller pack? You know, that could last us so that the worms don't come into the picture. So I'm still traumatized even today. I was raised on a diet of worms. Like, what is this? And to make matters worse, you know, in Limpopo, we also eat masonja. So it's just worms and worms. Like, it was hectic. Like, you know, in the pub, there's worms, then the shishero is worms, like it was empty. So I know that you guys, you don't have those type of problems. So if I send Mukhali to go to the shops,
to buy an 80 kilogram of mealie, and I give him a wheelbarrow, and he goes, and I give him, I don't know how much it is now, let's assume it's 80 rands, and I give him 100 rands, and 250, 500, 350, I give him 400 rands, two notes of 200 rands, and he goes to the shop, and when he arrives at the shop, he buys, and then the, you know, the shopkeeper is really excited about this sale and gives him a lollipop for free. And as soon as he gets the lollipop for free, he leaves the millibin, he leaves the wheelbarrow, he leaves the change, and he comes. He calls me Rahad. And then he comes to the house and he says, this is not a true story, eh? Did I mention that? The hypothetical story. So he comes and he says, Rahadi, okay, Rahadi, Rahadi. And then he says, Rahadi, Rahadi. And look at what the shopkeeper gave me. Oh, this is so exciting. I got it for free. I didn't have to pay for it. And I can't be excited for him. Wakali, where's the mealie mealie? Yahali, yahali, they gave me a lollipop. Wakali, where's the change? Wakali, where's the wheelbarrow? I mean, you left here with all these things, and then the only thing that you come back with is the lollipop. So sometimes that's how we behave. With when God wants to call us into something. Because you are busy with a lollipop. Your plans without God are like that lollipop. You have left the substance of your life behind because you are chasing something that you think God is taking away from you. God will never call you to something that is lower than where you are. When I was your age, some 20-something years ago, when I was your age, or maybe some 15 years ago, but I think I'm even to 9, I think I'm more than 10 years older than everyone. You know? So when I was your age and I thought about being called into the ministry, I thought it was a bitter pill. I thought God reserved the ministry for the children that were the most disobedient and the dumbest. And I did not want to be called into this thing because to me, it looked like something that was less than my life of engineering. So when God says, follow me, I thought God was asking me to do something less than what I had planned for myself. So when God says, follow me in corporate, he is not necessarily saying, leave corporate. He's saying, as you lead in corporate, lead as my disciple. As you lead in politics, lead as my disciple. As you lead in business as an entrepreneur, as you lead in the ministry, lead as my disciple. The saddest thing is that even in the ministry, we have leaders in the ministry who are not disciples. They are our pastors, they are our fathers in the faith, they are our mothers in the such a thing, but they are not disciples themselves. They are leading the institution, but they are not following Christ. So wherever God stations you, in the schools, in government, in business, in corporate, in the social, you know, environment, everywhere that God, in economics, globally, wherever God places us, remember, before you are a manager, before you are a CEO, before you are a politician, you are a disciple, and everything else that comes will find you occupying your position as a disciple. So everything else that comes will find that foundation that you are led. Again, I explained that which led I'm talking about. Will find that foundation already in place. We need you. We need you to be intentional about leading. When you are not intentional about leading, we end up being led by people with a lower capacity than yours. When you refuse to lead us in politics, when you refuse to lead us in the church, when you refuse to lead us in the corporate world, people who are of a lesser, of a lower capacity, people who don't have the capacity to lead people and allow them to shine, will lead us and want to dim our lights. Because you, with the greater capacity, you step back. Leadership is not easy. Leadership for many of us, especially for women, is not an obvious choice.
So when I started leading, and most of my leadership, I think I started here when I was at Vets. In high school, I think I didn't really understand the concept of leading. And also my disadvantage was that I was the youngest in school. So maybe sometimes people just like, oh, no, 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 no. And then they don't take you seriously, you know, you're trying to lead them. So that did not necessarily work very well for me. But when I was at CAF, and I was introduced to the teams and to things like the constitution, I never thought a girl from Butokwakhe and amend the constitution. I remember we were sitting there, you know, speaking very complicated English. And when I tried to think about where I come from, well, there's no plumbing, I was like, this is amazing. So only when I came to CAF did my eyes start to open to what it could mean for a girl like me to lead. And I stood for leadership as, I said, vibe? No, it was social action. Is it still the same? Yes. Social action. And I stood with a guy called Rupo. I was not popular. I had just come into CAF and I lost. And a kurikari, yeah. I've been suspecting when they don't like me. Now they proved it with the ballots. You know, and I thank God for that loss. Because after that time, I've never had to stand with anyone. And maybe it will sound like I'm boasting, but Kev, there's nothing to boast about. They never even paid us. They used to give us Mari biscuit and some juice called Wild Island or something like that. Which up to this day, I do not drink that juice. Dude, are you still drinking it? Because with us, we're even eating from Comrade biscuits. They were not even the proper thing. Because after that, as I was saying, I stood uncontested. But I thank God, because every time if I say I'm standing for something, then people don't stand anymore. Because I don't know if I was intimidating them into not standing, or they were just saying, no, you are the right leader. I don't know what they say. Or I was just fortunate if no one else was interested in the position as the only one who's interested. But there's one thing that was today when I was thinking about that time when I lost, that I thought about. A lot of people, when they lose elections at CAF, they don't serve in the year that they lost. Because you are always standing for selfish reasons. So when your selfishness gets exposed, you must rise above it. There's nothing wrong. Because it hurts, guys, to lose elections. You are writing there your manifesto, being saying powerful things. After you've written all your powerful things, they still don't vote for you. And when you listen to the other person's manifesto, your election doesn't sound as powerful as yours. But they still choose the other person. So God is also dealing with our egos. So firstly, for you to put yourself out there and say, guys, allow me to lead you. You put yourself in a very vulnerable position. But it's important for us to be in that position because it teaches us that leading is not about you. Leading is about serving the people. And if it means you must wait another year because they didn't choose you this year, have the humility to wait another year. Don't say they didn't choose me, I'll never stand again. Don't say they didn't choose me and go and join, let me mention the church side, JTL, or go and join LGTG, or go and join Change, but you can come and join CJC. So we need those humbling moments so that they can reveal to us where the ego, selfish ambition are at play in our lives. Because we need to deal with those things so that they can allow us to be servant leaders. Secondly, for most of us, especially women, and this may apply to some of the guys, especially who come from a more conservative background, especially rural backgrounds where you are not supposed to be too out there and to be, I'm the leader, I'm the boss, let's do, like, where you lead more as a collective. Whereas in the suburbs, they're just like my way or the highway. But there in the villages, you are trying to lobby everyone so that you can decide when to bury your grandmother, but it's your grandmother. You know, so for those of us who come from those conservative environments, we don't lead in a very confrontational way. We lead collectively, so as to say. So if you come from those environments, confrontation is very difficult. It's very difficult for you to stand in front of a person and say you are not performing.
It's very difficult for you to stand in front of a person and say, you will not talk to people like that. Let me give you an example-ish, and I've deleted from my text. So I had this brilliant idea. Well, not my most brilliant, but one of the lesser brilliant ones. Like, we are going to do a prison ministry. We found a prison called Los Prefontaine. I got the girls together, and we drove to Los Prefontaine. When we arrived in Los Prefontaine, we had platters. I told them that they must dress in their loose, most loose clothes that make them look like old mamas, because we are going to a prison with men, and I do not want anybody's flesh or anything close to a flesh that is showing. If you could wear those Muslim things, wear them. Then we made platters and we arrived in prison. I don't know what we were expecting. And when we arrived in prison, there was one warden who took us to the maximum side of the prison, kept opening doors and closing behind us, opening doors and with a huge key like this, opening doors and closing behind us. By the time we were done, we had arrived at the maximum section. It was the five of us, or was it 10 of us? I don't remember if we were going in one or two cars. I think it was the five of us. It was the five of us, and we were sitting around the table with 12 prisoners and one warden who did not have a gun. And as we were sitting there, they said to us, before we start with the program, we would like to introduce ourselves to you. They started, my name is whoever, whoever. I was an Inca, a hitman for the taxi drivers. I don't know the number of guys that I've killed. Now the faith, all the faith. That is when I noticed that the warden did not have a gun. The other one, I killed my girlfriend because she tried to dump me. The other one is a serial rapist. Like, you know, that Pella, we are in Mexima. Us and our, I don't know where we left our brains, but we actually wrote on the attendance register, and we wrote our names and surnames and our cell numbers. So after that, we did not even eat the food, because as soon as we opened the platters, they ate everything, including the lettuces that we had used to garnish the food. And they told me that, I mean, they don't know the last time they saw a lettuce, because there's no lettuce in prison, apparently. So we didn't even eat, we just figured we'd eat at home. So after that, okay, we left, it was a good meeting, we decided that we were going to work with them. When we arrived at home, they started harassing the girls. Because remember, we put our phone numbers on the attendance register. They started calling the girls, say, I want to marry you. I mean, one of the girls, they even sent her a parcel, flowers, at her work in Nell Spring. So this guy found her address and sent a parcel, flowers, and I don't remember what else, at her workplace. And I had to call that one who said he was a serial killer because he was the chairperson of their organization. And I called him and I told him very sternly, get your boys off my girls. Hey. Tell them they must never call any of those girls again, or they will have me to deal with. With what? And I was very stern. And when he was trying to explain himself, I was explaining to him how unacceptable it is. Mm. And at the end of that conversation, he apologized. Mm. He told me that he will speak to them personally. And he hung up and they stopped harassing the girls. Mm. But let me tell you, when I was on that phone, Nikki Sheik, make it like this. But I had to make sure that my voice does not show how scared I am, because I'm just thinking, what if he says, I'm going to send my voice after you? I'm just like, because there I am saying they will help me. So you may not have to face something that drastic. You may not have to face something that dangerous. But any time that you put yourself in a position to lead, you are putting yourself in a position to do things that are uncomfortable. And many of us, because we are afraid of doing the things that are uncomfortable, we vacate our place of leadership and we never do what God has called us to do. Let's go back to our text. We have 10 minutes. So when God calls them, he says, when Jesus calls them, he says, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. So when God calls them, he already tells them that he is calling them to a place of leadership. He doesn't say, I'm going to prepare you and see if you can fish men. He doesn't say, no, top three out of you will be fishers of men. He makes the objective clear from the beginning. Follow me and I will make you fishers of men. So you may have been born again yesterday or last week or the month ago or a year ago. You may feel like you don't know enough scriptures. You don't really hear the voice of the Lord. But wherever you are, the minute you decide to
person that brings the light, and the light brings with it leadership. Because people must always gravitate towards you as the light in a dark place. So you automatically assume a place of leadership. So when God calls us, I know that there's a wide variety of vision here, different visions. Whatever it is that God calls you to, God is calling you to a place of leadership. Just because you are following in one area does not mean you will follow in every area. So many of us who are used to following are even ceding the place where we are supposed to be leaders to another person. So, for example, when they are singing, I follow. When they are playing the keyboard, maybe I don't even feature. You know, when they are doing whatever, when they are ushering, I follow. But when they are, if let's say at CJC there's an X committee, it doesn't matter that Lindy Way is the chairperson. When I'm there in my capacity as a leader. They can't ask me, Pastor Mancha, when must we go again? Let me go and consult at the bishop. There's no bishop. So most of us, what do we do in the areas where God has called us to lead? We are not leading in the areas where God has called us to lead and lead, and there is a vacancy, there is a leadership vacuum in that area. Some of you are the most educated person in your family, but you're not providing career counseling to any of your cousins, your nieces and your nephews. You ask them, what are you studying? When you should be involved in how they choose their careers, because you are the most educated person. Nobody in your family has ever seen the chair of a varsity. You are the first one. So who do you think is advising the rest of your clan when the only thing you're concerned about is slaying on Instagram? So we vacate our positions of leadership because we don't recognize them. You think I will lead when I'm a CEO, but there are pockets where God has placed you already, where you are supposed to be leading. And when you are not leading, people there are leaderless. They don't have a leader. And Jesus, verse 23, went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people. Then his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought to him all sick people who were afflicted with various diseases and torments, and those who were demon-possessed, epileptic, and paralytic, and he healed them. Great multitudes followed him from Galilee and from Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, and beyond the Jordan. So Jesus finds people fishing. He says to them, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. So my expectation is that Jesus must then sit them down and say, this is how you fish men. He must put fishing classes, men classes, whatever it is. I don't know, whatever it is. But he must show them, he must teach them, he must say to them, do you see me? I am healing. This is how you fish men. Do you see me? I'm teaching. This is how you fish men. But he doesn't do that. Jesus spent the next 3.5 years doing what is summarized from verse 23 to verse 25. He spends that time performing miracles, and when he performs miracles, he doesn't say, watch me now. He doesn't say, where's the video? Where's the camera? Put this on YouTube. He doesn't say that. Jesus is working with 12 people, and he's pouring himself into those 12 people. And even as he's pouring himself, he's not saying, now this is the service of impartation. Come, I want to impart the anointing upon you. He is just being himself. And in being himself, they are learning how to be fishers of men. So, how do we lead and how do we follow? We observe what Jesus is doing and we do it. And when we do it, we don't have to say, watch me. This is how we fish men. When I see you doing it, and I see eyes opened, I see the lame healed, I see the demon possessed freed, I realize that this is what it means to fish men. So, when you lead, no matter how amazing you are, you lead because you have learned from somewhere. Jesus is teaching us how to lead. If you observe Peter in the book of Acts, when he then stands up and says, no guys, we are not drunk, we are filled with the Holy Spirit, it's because he had seen Jesus addressing multitudes for a very long time without a PA system. He knows how it's done. Can I start to say, guys, no, raise the volume. They didn't have instruments. He had seen Jesus doing it for years. He had seen how Jesus dealt with sick people. He finds a guy by the gate, beautiful, and he says, such as I have, silver and gold we do not have, but such as I have, I give you, rise up in the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. Because he had seen Jesus doing it so often, he doesn't have to say to his companion, to check, come for this. Watch this face. Because that one, Jesus was never, so the way they are walking, when you observe them, that's why they call them Christians. They did not call them Christians because they kept saying, we belong to Christ, we belong to Christ. When they observed how they walked, they saw how Jesus had walked for 3.5 years, and they said they are walking like that Jesus guy. That's why we are calling them Christians. So, how you are going to lead in the corporate world, in politics, in government, in our education system, in politics, when some of you will be drawing up policies, some of you will do important global work. How you lead in those areas, remember, it must come from a place of I am a disciple. And what is a disciple? A disciple is not a follower of a papa or a mentor or a whatever, a spiritual father or a whatever. A disciple is a follower of Christ. Basically, there is no in between. You don't have to go to Christ via your papa. No. When you go to Christ, there is no second generation of disciples where Jesus is my grandfather because Jesus is my father's father. All of us, we have a direct link to Jesus. Every single one of us. The one who was born again 23 years ago versus the one who was born again 10 years ago, 5 years ago, 1 year ago, 2 weeks ago. All of us, we are disciples of Christ and Christ alone. And as we follow him, we will lead like him. We used to wear these bracelets. What would Jesus do? And there's an organization now that's called Lead Like Jesus. You know, I've been listening to Mark Cherona, and he was talking about, he's a leadership expert, he's also a pastor, and he was talking about the fact that right now, churches in America, their model for growing church is based on the McDonald's franchise model. Because McDonald's is one of the most successful franchises. And churches, what they are doing is that they are using the same model. And the two premises of that model, number one is good real estate. So if you check in every city, some of the best real estate, some of the best property is owned by McDonald's. So they do a study. So McDonald's is actually not in the business of beggars. It's in the business of property. It's a real estate company. They own a lot of real estate and they buy prime real estate. So they study traffic and all these things, and they will make sure that they get a very good spot. So number one, they will get a good piece of real estate. And what is the number one thing that churches raise funds for? Buildings. And even if you took, and it's not a recent thing, even in the past, in Europe, etc., some of the most beautiful churches, if you were a high-profile architect, chances are you built a church in one of the greatest European cities. So that's why the Leonardo da Vinci's, their paintings are in Catholic churches, because that was the prime real estate at the time. Secondly, McDonald's is based on a premise of the fastest service possible. They time their service. You need to get your burger by a certain amount of minutes. And what our church is trying to do now, give you the shortest possible worship experience. Hey. 2 worship songs, 1 minute announcements, 10 seconds preaching, no altar calls because there's no time. So our churches are full, but there is no impact. Come on. Oh, now Jesus, 3-day message. Jesus, do you know that Jesus performed that miracle for 5,000 people because there was a need? People were hungry. They had been with him for 3 days. He had been preaching for 3 days. People were hungry, and he just said, no, there's a crisis here. Let me just multiply the bread so that these people can eat. So Paul preached until someone fell and died. Like, not only was he preaching long messages, they were long and boring. Guys, in the Old Testament, they would stand and the Bible would be read while they were, no one was interpreting, they were just going through it. Yeah, when you are on your periods, don't come to church. And people are standing there. the whole day. Yeah. If you touch the dead cow, don't touch other people. Stay outside for the whole week. And where do we get this idea of church as we do it today? Who disciples are we? So it, even in business, when people say there's a certain way of doing business that is not Christ-like, when we do business that way, who is discipling us? Who is our father? Who are we following? Who are we leading like? So, Bazalwane, all of us are called to lead. All of us. And I wanted to say this at the beginning, I forgot, and you know, the Spirit of the Lord just reminded me. So let me see if you are a woman and you are a speaker or you're an aspiring speaker, just stand up, let's see. No one. Okay, thank you. Yes. Three people. Stand up. Is that kind of yes? Amen. I know that there's more. Even if you have never spoken on a home way, it's fine. Or your English sounds like mine. I mean, if I could be a speaker, guys, anyone can be a speaker. We're done. So let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, see me after the service. Let's stand up on our feet. So I just want us to quickly make a commitment to lead. Right? So I'll speak and you follow me. Lord Jesus.
Thank you
for calling me to be a leader.
Thank you that you have modeled for me
what it means to be an effective leader.
What it takes to get results.
Today,
I say yes to the call of leadership.
I will lead in corporate.
I will lead in business,
in education,
in politics,
in church and the ministry,
and in any area that you have placed me.
In Jesus' name.
Father,
I pray for boldness.
The boldness to step out of my comfort zone.
To learn new things.
To prepare myself.
And to be intentional
about leading
in this generation.
Thank you
that you are raising us up
as leaders,
as a light,
as a sound voice
for this generation.
In the name of Jesus,
I rebuke all fear.
I rebuke all thoughts
that says I'm not good enough,
that says I'm inadequate.
I know
that you have equipped me
with everything
that I need to lead
in this generation.
I silence every voice
that says I cannot do it.
I silence every voice
that says not me,
in Jesus' name.
And I receive every word
that says yes, the time is right.
And I will occupy until you come,
in Jesus' name.
Amen.